for his donkey that he rode in on. So we are here today to worship the King. I'd ask you to join me in the call to worship that's printed in your bulletin. Rejoice, people of Zion. Shout for joy, you people of Jerusalem.
Look, your King is coming to you.
Your King comes to you triumphant and victorious. Let us worship God, and let's pray. Heavenly Father, we do thank you that you have made your Son Jesus King over the entire creation, from here, from this sanctuary, to the edge of the universe. Jesus is King. We do worship you, Lord Jesus, and we pray that by your Spirit, you would enable our worship to be pleasing your Heavenly Father, to honor your holy name. Amen. Our first hymn is one of the great Palm Sunday hymns. It's in the worship book number 424. 424 in the worship book, Hosanna. Christ is a new creation. The old has gone and the new has come. Friends, believe this gospel. In Jesus Christ we are forgiven. And then all God's people say, amen.
Amen.
Amen. And now we'll do our contactless passing of the peace. We just wave to each other. So the peace of the Lord Jesus be with you all. Peace be with you all. And I ask you if you could all join me together. We'll say it out loud together. The peace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Ready? The peace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Amen. Amen. And now for the glory of God. So this is the King who comes with salvation, and he's riding what? A donkey. Yeah. So this is an Old Testament prophecy. It's towards the end of the Old Testament. The Old Testament comes in, let's see, the New Testament starts just a few pages later. See, here's the beginning. See, it says the New Testament, right? So you see, that's only a few pages. Actually, half of the pages are maps. Look at that. That's at the very end of the Old Testament, right? Only like, of all these pages, there's only like 10 left, right? So, over in the New Testament, riding in a donkey, who does he claim to be? Who is it that rides in on the donkey according to Zechariah? Your, who is it? See? No, your, what's next? What's that? Your king. Yeah, that's who he's claiming to be. He says, I'm the king who Zechariah told you was going to come. Okay? All right, let's have a prayer. We're too scattered here to hold hands today, so let's just pray. Heavenly Father, I do thank you for bringing all these children here today, and I pray that you will fill them with your Spirit, that they would know your love and your grace and your mercy, and that you would draw them into your kingdom. And I pray that you would surround them with your mighty angels, guard and protect them from harm and evil in the week ahead. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I'd ask the deacons to come forward after worship to distribute the palms to whoever wants to take some.
downstairs on Palm Sunday, but it's going to be a super coffee hour next Sunday. So those are my announcements. Does anyone else have anything?
Just one more question. Since Billy was here last time, he had a procedure, and I just wanted to say he's doing great. He's back playing.
Great. Anyone else have anything before we pray today? Yeah, go ahead.
Anniversary on the 12th, if you want to know.
you show us your way of life. We ask that you would bless us now through these words we're about to hear. Amen. Our first reading for today is a short passage from Hebrews chapter 5, verses 7 to 10. This passage is generally assumed to be describing Jesus' prayer in Gethsemane, in the Garden of Gethsemane, which will be our main reading in Matthew's Gospel. Now, so far in this worship service, it's all been about Palm Sunday. I don't know if you noticed. Our call to worship, both of our hymns, the children's message, they're all centered around Palm Sunday. But this Sunday has two names. Palm Sunday is one. Passion Sunday is the other. This is the Sunday before Good Friday, the day that Jesus died. And so that's called the Passion of the Christ. So this is also Passion Sunday. Now we're going to turn to that. And the Passion really begins on Thursday night, maybe with the Last Supper, but definitely in Gethsemane. So we're going to read now. This is written many years later, looking back at what happened to Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. So this is a description of how the earliest Christians understood what was going on in the passage we're about to read in Matthew chapter 26. So Hebrews chapter 5, verses 7 to 10. In his life on earth, Jesus made his prayers and requests with loud cries and tears to God, who could save him from death. Because he was humble and devoted, God heard him. But even though he was God's son, he learned through his sufferings to be obedient. When he was made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all those who obeyed him. And God declared him to be high priest in the priestly order of Melchizedek. So that's a little description of Jesus' prayer in Gethsemane. Let's turn now to Matthew chapter 26. We're going to read verses 36 to 46. That is Jesus' prayer, the story of Jesus' prayer in Gethsemane. A couple things to note about this. If you look up, if you have your pew Bible open and you look at the right under that little graphic there, that little image at the top left, it says Jesus eats the Passover meal with his disciples. That's the Last Supper. This is Thursday night of Holy Week. So Jesus and his disciples just ate the Last Supper, and that's where Jesus instituted what we now call the Sacrament of Communion. That's where the Sacrament of Communion originated, was in Jesus' Last Supper. So that has just happened, and now they go out, they leave the city of Jerusalem, where they had celebrated Passover, and they go out. And those of you who are going on the trip to the pilgrimage to Israel in a few weeks, we will actually visit the place, the stone where Jesus kneeled. It's inside a big church called the Church of All Nations in the Garden of Gethsemane at the foot of the Mount of Olives. Now, what kind of trees do you think covered the Mount of Olives? Olive trees? Right? So at the bottom, right, they shake all the olives loose and let them all roll down to the bottom of the hill. And at the bottom of the hill, what do you do with olives once you pick them? Now, you might think you eat them, but that's not the main purpose of olives in the ancient world. It was to make olive oil. So Gethsemane means place of the olive press. In other words, this is a place where things get crushed. And that's what happens to Jesus in this passage. He's beginning to feel the crushing power, the weight of the sin of the world that he will soon die for a few hours later. So let's pick up now. Jesus prays in Gethsemane with his 12 disciples, and then names three of them, Peter and the two sons of Zebedee. The two sons of Zebedee are James and John. So let's pick up now in verse 36. Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane. And he said to them, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." He took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee. Grief and anguish came over him. And he said to them, "The sorrow in my heart is so the three disciples and found them asleep. And he said to Peter, "How is it that you three were not able to keep watch with me for even 1 hour? Keep watch and pray that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." Once more, Jesus went away and prayed, "My Father, if this cup of suffering cannot be taken away unless I drink it, your will be done." He returned once more
eternal Lord, King of the universe, be with us now. Fill our hearts and minds with your word and with your spirit. Amen. Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane. And he said to them, "Sit here while I go over there and pray." He took with him Peter and the two sons of Zebedee, James and John. Grief and anguish came over him. On this Passion Sunday, we examine Jesus' prayer. His prayer in Gethsemane, the place where things get crushed. Notice Jesus felt a desperate need to pray. He needed to pray in order to prepare himself to face the suffering and the evil that was just in front of him. Now, if Jesus needed to pray, then how much more do we need to pray when we face difficult times of suffering or trials? Well, today we'll explore this issue, starting with the aid of our passage from Hebrews chapter 5. In chapter 5, verses 7 and 8, we read that God heard Jesus' prayers, and yet Jesus learned through his sufferings. God can hear our prayers, hear in the good sense of receiving them positively due to humility and devotion, as in Jesus' case, as verse 7 says. God can hear our prayers, yet not do what we ask. In fact, Jesus may allow the very thing we prayed against to happen. How can that be a legitimate answer? Well, Hebrews 5 teaches us how. First, you must understand the evil thing we prayed against, if it happens, that is not God's answer. That is not God's will. Evil is a violation of God's will, not the fulfillment of God's will. God's answer is the strength, the perseverance, the willpower he gives us that enables us to accomplish God's goal through what we suffer. The miracle of perseverance, and in Jesus' case and in many, the cases of many of God's saints, it is an outright miracle of perseverance. To persevere despite suffering, despite evil. This miracle of perseverance enables us to remain godly right in the middle of suffering and evil. We receive the ability to resist becoming evil. Given the fallen, the sinful status of our hearts, the natural response to evil for humans is to respond to evil with more evil. Just in continuing the cycle of evil, of violence. You don't have to look very far around in the world today to see that happening, not just in Ukraine, but in New York City, all across America. People respond to evil with evil. God's miraculous power to persevere is the power to resist becoming evil in response to evil being done to us. Instead, we allow God's light to shine through us and illuminate the darkness. God's light shines through us in the midst of a dark world. That is God's will for suffering. The triumph of our love for God and our love for people over the evils confronting us in this world. When we triumph in that way, God's kingdom advances, defeating the evil powers. Now, with that background, listen again to the passage we read from Hebrews chapter 5. Jesus made his prayers and requests with wild cries and tears to God, who could save him from death. God could have saved Jesus in Gethsemane. In fact, Jesus prayed for that. God could have saved Jesus from death, but did not. God allowed the thing Jesus prayed against, his death by crucifixion, God allowed that very thing to happen. Why? So that, as verse 8 informs us, even though he was God's son, he learned through his suffering. What did Jesus learn through his awful suffering on the cross? Verse 9 reveals the answer. When he was made perfect, when he was perfected by his suffering and his death, Jesus became the source of eternal salvation for all those who obey him. In other words, God's answer to Jesus' loud and tearful prayers in Gethsemane was to allow the very thing Jesus asked not to happen. Because God's answer was to give Jesus the strength, the spiritual power to remain obedient to his heavenly Father's will through it all. Now, as a result, God's kingdom is victorious over the powers of evil. They have been defeated. That's what we celebrate next Sunday on Easter. God did not require the suffering and death of his only begotten Son for inadequate or capricious reasons. Jesus' death is the direct cause of eternal salvation that's now available to the human race. Without prayer, Jesus could not have accomplished this goal. His prayers, our prayers, are the method God uses to help us survive in a fallen and sinful world where we encounter evil on a regular basis. I say it again, if Jesus needed to pray, how much more do we? What is the status of your prayer life? Perhaps God brings trouble into your life because he's trying to wake you up. You need to pray more. So I'm going to send into your life something that's going to drive you to your knees to pray. If Jesus needed to pray, how much more do we? This is one of the lessons Gethsemane teaches us. It's interesting. God never asks us to do something that he won't do. God brought this unto Jesus for one of the reasons God brought this unto Jesus was to lead him into prayer. Now let's turn directly to Jesus' prayer, to that prayer in Gethsemane, in our passage in Matthew 26. The issue Jesus prays about, it's the will of God and his own will. What is God's will, and will I follow it? That's a prayer that we can share with Jesus. Jesus struggled to remain attuned to the will of God as the powers of evil surround him and close in for the kill. Friends, a person who is outside of God's will is in a different situation than a person who does not know God's will. To seek God's will is not a sin. That's what Jesus did. By prayer, we, like Jesus, tune our hearts, our spiritual ears, to hear God's will. By prayer, we conform our will to God's will. Listen to Jesus' prayer. My Father, if it is possible, take this cup know it's your will that I drink that cup. Help me to will that too. Because right now, I'm struggling. This is a great purpose for prayer. Not asking God to give me lots of stuff, but asking God to conform my will to His will. In verse 39, Jesus asks to be released. But in verse 42, He changes slightly. He prays something similar. If it is not possible for this cup to be taken away, your will be done. In verse 44, he goes back to pray to God again. It took Jesus some time. He references the disciples waiting an hour. So this took some time, and it took Jesus three trips, you might say, to the prayer closet to align his will with his Father's. We should expect it to take longer for us. Once that happens, the fear of being overwhelmed, the doubt, the questions, they all disappear. What a changed attitude Jesus displays at the end of our passage. In verses 45 and 46, Jesus declares, "Look, the hour has come for the Son of Man to be handed over to sinners. Get up. Let's go." Now, after prayer, Jesus oozes confidence. Confidence that will stay with him. Life within God's will, when our will corresponds to the Father's will, all things become easy. All trials come to us with peace. All suffering can be borne. The Apostle Paul wrote, "I can do all things when God strengthens me." That's all true. Still, I want to return to Gethsemane, to perhaps, for Christians, the most shocking element of Jesus' prayer in the garden. God said no to a prayer of Jesus. Learn, in your Gethsemane, do not be shocked if God answers no to your prayer. Learn from Jesus about prayer during the Gethsemanes of life. Jesus' prayer in the Garden of Gethsemane is unique among his prayers because Jesus' prayer suggests he wants no for an answer. The famous phrase, not my will, but yours be done, reveals that Jesus knows what the answer will be. Yet he prays anyway. Well, what's going on here? If Jesus realizes his heavenly Father's answer is no, well, then what's Jesus asking for? Why is he asking? Now, you or I might add, your will, not mine, be done to our prayers, because we really don't know God's will. We don't understand it. We know only our own will, and we are submitting our will to our Father in heaven, trusting his will for us to be better than our own. Well, that's reasonable coming from us. But as God's only begotten Son, Jesus prays from a different basis than we do. He does know the will of God. So we must repeat the question, what's going on here? If Jesus already knows his Father's will is no, what is he actually asking for? I don't think Jesus asks a straightforward question. He's not actually asking for God to remove this. But that's an assertion on my part that must be proven. Because in a plain reading of the text, Jesus does ask the question, can this cup of suffering be removed? Can we save humanity from sin, Jesus asks, without my death on the cross? And Jesus knew the answer is no. Now, as evidence that Jesus knew precisely what would happen to him, I want to spend a minute or two briefly rehearsing some of Jesus' prophecies about the cross. From Matthew chapter 16, Jesus said that he must go to Jerusalem, suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed, and on the third day be raised. In Matthew chapter 20, we're going up to Jerusalem. The Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests and scribes, and they will condemn him to death and deliver him over to the Gentiles to be mocked and flogged and crucified, and will be raised on the third day. Mark chapter 10, the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. Luke chapter 13, I must go on my way, for it cannot be that a prophet should perish, should die, away from Jerusalem. Luke chapter 18, everything written about the Son of Man by the prophets will be accomplished. He will be delivered over to the Gentiles, and he will be mocked and shamefully treated and spit on, and after flogging him, they will kill him. And on the third day, he will rise. Finally, to include examples from all four Gospels, John chapter 10, Jesus said, I lay my life down for the sheep, only to take it up again. But we could quote many more examples of Jesus' prophecies about exactly what was going to happen Thursday night and Friday and then Easter Sunday. You notice how often he insisted that he would rise on the third day. They all, the ones that we've quoted, suffice to make the point. Jesus knew he would die by crucifixion. Jesus' multiple references to his suffering, to being a ransom for sinners, of dying in Jerusalem. And most significantly, remember when this happened, Jesus had just instituted the sacrament of communion based on the sacrifice of his body and blood, along with the prophecy that one of the 12 would betray him. There can be no doubt, Jesus expected to die, and he knew that this was the night. This is the night that it was going to happen. He knew it. He just said so at the Last Supper. Now back to Jesus' prayer in Gethsemane. He knew what was about to happen, and he knew with certainty that it was his Father's will that he suffered. So the purpose of his prayer, it's not an attempt to avoid this fate or to abandon God's plan for salvation. We already know that the phrase, not my will, but yours be done, reveals Jesus' knowledge. Something else is going on here. Jesus' question is not a straightforward request for an answer, for information, for something to happen. What's going on is what our reading from Hebrews suggested. This is the perfection of the Lamb. The perfection of the Lamb who was about to be sacrificed. The perfection of Jesus' sacrifice. Learn to let Jesus' prayer in Gethsemane guide your prayer. Jesus prayers for the praise for the Father to perfect the desires of his heart so that they match the Father's will. This is the perfection of the sacrifice that would happen a few hours later on the cross. When Jesus prayed, not my will, but yours, in verse 39, again in verse 42, and then the third time in verse 44, Jesus was not expecting his heavenly Father to answer yes. We've seen that Jesus understood what was about to happen to him. Jesus always knew that the answer was no. He knew he must die on the cross as a ransom for sinners. Jesus fully expected to die and not be saved at the last minute. Jesus knew in advance what was the answer to his prayer in the garden. This is not a foresaw the via dolorosa that he must walk, the way of sorrows and suffering. This is a test that cannot be avoided. It is the eternal destiny of the Son of God to be tested, and the testing time has come. It's now. But eternal destiny doesn't make it easy. Jesus really suffered excruciating pain. That pain really overcame his mind on the cross when his heart cries out, my God, why have you forsaken me? When Jesus prays in the garden asking for the cup of horrors to pass him by, even then he knows he's going to drink it to the bottom. But his will, his heart, had not yet joined his mind, had not yet fully committed to the task. He prays in order to align his will with his Father's will. Only when Jesus has fully committed himself to the task ahead can he begin. His sacrifice has now been perfected. He is ready. And the Father gives his Son the time he needs. Only then, in verse 45, does Judas arrive. Now, Jesus is ready. He has submitted his will to the Father's good and perfect will. The Holy Spirit inspired the gospel writers to include this really difficult prayer of Jesus' in Gethsemane. The Holy Spirit caused the gospel writers to include this story to encourage us to pray through our own trials in life, and to encourage us to follow Jesus' footsteps, to live on the way of the cross. Friends, my prayer is that during this Holy Week that starts today, you will contemplate Jesus' prayer in Gethsemane. I pray that you will ask, Father, where is my cross? Then join Jesus in Gethsemane praying, not my will, but yours be done. Ask the Spirit to conform your heart, your will, to the Father's heart and will, to join your heart with Jesus' heart. Will you follow in his footsteps? Will you offer the rest of your days on this earth to God, to the service of his kingdom, to the message of his gospel? Will you? Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, it is so difficult to seek the cross you have prepared for us in this life. Jesus' cross was more difficult than ours, but that doesn't make ours easy. So, Father, we do pray that you would guide our minds, that you would lead our hearts, that you would be our good shepherd, and that you would lead us to the place where we can become prepared for whatever the future holds. We ask this in the name of the one who died on the cross for our sins. The name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. And now, Elder Idali Torres Quinones.